number 30 is a passage of scripture. Before this tragedy happened last week, I was planning to preach on the call of David. David, young shepherd boy, was being called by God through the prophet Samuel to lead the nation of Israel. And I was speaking last week, I was going to speak on having a heart that matters, in a particular text where David is being called. There are all kinds of criteria that even the prophet himself, Samuel, was looking for to help him anoint the next king of Israel. He was looking for stature. He was looking for appearance and beauty. He was looking for all these physical characteristics. And God told the prophet, which always reminds me that a prophet is always subject to correction. Somebody say amen. And just because you're a follower of God, or even being used in formal roles on behalf of God, then you don't always get it right. God helped the prophet and told the prophet that you may look on the outside, but God looks at the heart. So I'm then going to spend this Sunday building on this theme of David and talking a little bit about this responsibility, particularly since it's Father's Day, of this king, this man of taking care of his community. And I decided to stay with this text because often when tragedy happens, I can find myself finding it very difficult to not just say what I want to say, you know. And I love it when scripture speaks because scripture can say things that even I can't think of, amen? But I do believe there's some fascinating and important principles in this text that I think can be very helpful for many of us as we move not just with emphasis on fathers and the important role that men play, but all of us as a community, the responsibility we have to be followers of God and followers of Jesus who are actually redeeming the world that is in need fallen. So, 1 Samuel chapter 30, now one of the important things I always appreciate that for many of us who are anti-violent, there is a very troubling, consistent presence of violence in Scripture. So it is indeed a text that always reflects human conditions, but also critiques them all at the same time. Amen? So just be reminded that even in our contradiction, God can still teach you and I a lesson. Somebody say amen. The first several verses, and I think they're on the screen. Oh, thank God. So now when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day, the Amalekites had made a raid on the Negev and on Ziklag. And they had attacked Ziklag, burned it down, and taken captive the women and all who were in it, both small and great. They killed none of them, but carried them off and went their way. And when David and his men came to the city, they found it burned down and their wives and sons and daughters taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him raised their voices and wept until they had no more strength to weep. David's two wives had been taken captive, Ahinoam of Jezreel and Abigail, the widow of Nabal of Carmel. David was in great danger, for the people spoke of stoning him, because all the people were bitter in spirit for their sons and daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. Yes. David said to the priest, Abiathar, son of Ahimelech, bring me the ephod. So Abiathar brought the ephod to David. David inquired of the Lord, shall I pursue this band? Shall I overtake them? He answered, pursue, for you shall surely overtake and will recover it all. It's the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. We're going to simply speak from the topic today. We will recover it all. We will recover it all. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Now, I am drawn to David for a number of different reasons. One of the reasons why I think he is a fascinating and important character study for all of us, particularly men in the church, is that he was someone with great contradictions and complexity. David was, you know, someone who had all kinds of gifts and talents at his disposal, and he used them for the saving of his house, for the saving of his country. He was someone chosen by God to be more than what he was in his station in life. And David also had flaws that bore themselves out very publicly. David was not a perfect individual by any stretch of the imagination. When you look at the life of David, he was a schemer, he was a manipulator, he was a murderer, he was an adulterer, he was someone who had all kinds of flaws. And yet, when the story is told about David, David is also narrated as someone after God's own heart. And it causes me to ask all kinds of questions, questions that I can't necessarily spend too much time focusing on today, because we would be here literally all day. And as much as y'all love the way, amen, I don't think y'all love it that much, praise the Lord. But I do want to certainly appreciate that one of the great contributions of David is that David seemed to be someone who was honest about his complexity. He was honest about the various struggles that he had, and he did not allow those struggles to get in the way of him fulfilling his assignment. And when you look at one of the legacies of David, that blesses us continuously, it is not that David slew the giant, although that story of the underdog, how many are glad that there's a story about an underdog that you can always look to? That's an important story. It is not that David was, you know, one of the longest tenured kings in the, you know, United Kingdom of Israel, although that is an important distinction. And it is not even that David found himself in the lineage of Jesus, our Savior, which I think is certainly important. To me, one of the greatest gifts of David is the Psalms. The Psalms, the book of Psalms, these records of Psalms. Of words that many of whom are attributed to David, certainly not all of them, but many of them have a certain kind of DNA in them that gives you and I gifts that help our spiritual walk be more vibrant, alive, and effective. These books in the Psalms, they are, as one theologian said, theology in search of experience, or I'm sorry, experience in search of theology. This one theologian, I like what they say. They talk about how the words of Scripture in the New Testament, Matthew through Revelation, they are often theology in search of experience. It is this starting point of the revelatory truth of Jesus that calls us forward to a life of conversion, commitment, and faithfulness. That when you see Jesus, we are starting with that altogether different and transcendent Savior of the world. And from that starting point, we all then are invited into a life to experience the truth that has been presented to us. Theology in search of experience. But when you see the Psalms, you are actually not beginning with a divine kind of declaration. You are, as you experience the Psalms, engaging in experience that is in search of theology. Experience, the materiality of human experiences and struggles, often seeking to make meaning and purpose by what is going on around you. It is this idea that you and I are people who can't just be focusing on only the spiritual without also being mindful of the material. That we, I believe, it is the exhaling and inhaling. It is both the most important part of what it means to be a follower of God, that when we find ourselves truly following God, our eyes are squarely fixed and our hearts are focused on the transcendent revelatory knowledge of Jesus on one hand, but it is also that our feet are firmly planted and our senses are sharply attuned to the reality of human struggle and suffering. Are you with me this morning? So I can keep my eyes focused on Jesus while my feet are firmly focused or planted on the ground. It is the function of our faith then to not serve as an escapism of sorts, but it is the function of our faith to make sure that as I stand in the middle of my trouble, I know that what I have been shown by God has the power to hold me in my material existence. Are you with me this morning? You see, I like David because David, a deeply flawed man, husband and father, was someone who was not willing to reduce his life and smooth over the complexities. And if there is one lesson for all of us, my brothers, sisters, all of us in this room today, is we need more people who are willing to deal with the complexity of human existence. This is why it is so important for you and I to resist the reductionist moves that are being made in our larger social conversations. It is a reductionist move to make this about gun laws. It is a reductionist move to make this about mental health. It is a reductionist move to make this only about race. It is a reductionist move to make this only about South Carolina. It is a reductionist move to make this only about this one single crazy person. How many of you know that there's a whole lot of complexity going on in this most recent public manifestation of the complexity of human suffering that we find at work in the United States of America, but proliferating all across this world? And part of what the church needs to do and what you and I need to realize is that God is calling for some folk who are willing to sit in the complexity of this struggle. Because where you are not willing to sit is where you may miss out on your answers. Lord, I wish I could talk to somebody here today. You see, it is important to appreciate what is at stake when you and I do not deal with the complexity, is that the complexities work themselves on us without our awareness. Now, there is trauma that has been inflicted on all of us through these kinds of incidents, and I was reading a report most recently that talked about how the kinds of continuous accumulative negative encounters that we are having, listen, are physiologically wearing our bodies out. In communities of color, black communities and poor communities, when we don't have access to health care and mental health and healing spaces, this weakening erodes us in such a way that we engage in behaviors and lifestyles that are not conducive to who God created us to be. So part of what I want you to understand, my brothers and sisters, that what is at stake for you and I not dealing with complexity is that we will find ourselves being grounded into dust by the very complexity we refuse to deal with. Versus us boldly grabbing a hold to the bull by the horns and appreciating that the same I had some honest folk today. Amen. But just because it's hard don't mean it's not necessary. Amen. That there are some things that you and I are going to have to go through. But if you and I can go through it like our ancestors have gone through it, like your mama and them have gone through it, like you yourself have gone through it, you'll find yourself better on the other side. PA. Even in what's going on in Charleston, and they have apprehended this perpetrator. I like what one of my mentors, he said it like this, that the perpetrator was caught, but the killer is still at large. And what is he talking about? What is he talking about? He's talking about that there are bigger kind of killing forces at work. It was named a few moments ago. One of them is called white supremacy. Amen. This idea, right, that the lives of certain folk are more valuable than the lives of other folk. It is one of the founding principles of not just this country, but of the modern era. That there has been an analysis that if you are not a wealthy white male elite, that your life is not as important in the whole kind of conversation around value. Now, is that white supremacy, it even works to oppress white folk. Amen. It's going to get a little heavy in here before it gets light. But touch a neighbor and tell them we going all the way today. Amen. We going all the way. You got to understand, my brothers and sisters, that white supremacy in and of itself, amen, it is only intended to benefit a small number of people. But when you over-identify with whiteness, whether you white, black, Asian, rich, poor, whatever, when you over-identify with an ideal that was never meant to describe who you are, then you'll find yourself being oppressed by the very thing that you are aspiring to. I didn't feel like preaching, but I feel a little bit of preach coming on. Give the neighbor a high five and tell them, don't you over-identify. And white supremacy and anti-immigrant and homophobia and all these different issues out here will not be solved by black and oppressed people alone. It means that all of us got some learning to do. Give your neighbor a high five and tell them, I gotta learn something, you know. And it don't mean you got to agree with everything. Amen. Amen. I may not like it. I have to learn that, you know, there are other teams besides the 49ers in the Bay Area. I may not like it. But when you learn knowledge, how many of you know knowledge helps to inform your way of living? Yeah. So these problems we're facing, they can't just be solved by oppressed people alone. And part of why we have to keep naming white supremacy and racism, it's because there are white brothers and sisters even in our churches, synagogues, mosques, temples, neighborhoods, White House, White House, in the legislature, in the city council, on the board of supervisors, folk who think that if they can just get a little bit more power, and a little bit more money, and a little bit more of this, that gets them closer to this ideal that they will be able then to be fully human. But the scriptures say that you are fearfully and wonderfully made just how you are. So you don't have to appeal trying to become more than what God has already created you to be. Can you pat yourself on the chest and say, God made me the wrong? Amen. Come on, it's all right. Some of us need to wake up every day in the mirror and remind ourselves that how God created me is how God meant for me to be. In the book of Jeremiah, he said it like this: before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you, I called you, I appointed you. That means that there ain't nothing about you that God didn't know was going to be there. Now, it don't mean that how you are is how you should stay, but you ought to let God be your timetable and not nobody else. Give your neighbor one more high five and tell them, I'm a work in progress. So you and I have to appreciate the historical nature of these perpetrators, of these killers that are out there. I remember reading a book about when the Irish became white. And it was a fascinating read. Some of you need to read some books that talk church in here today. So all of us who used to experience that kind of oppression in our history, we have to have empathy, sympathy, and openness to understanding that that oppression has not gone anywhere. It's still here today, and it is still an onslaught on our senses and our humanity. But this is where I believe the scriptures give you and I some good indication of what we need to do moving forward. In this chapter here, we see David having all of these victories and successes. He is someone who is living in a moment where he has just defeated almost every enemy he could imagine. But he comes back after fighting his fights, and he sees that something has happened on his watch when he was not there for a moment in time. And it gives you and me an opportunity to think of a few things that I think are important if we are going to recover everything. The first thing that I want to lift up is that the scripture says that we, or David, and all of his men were together, and they all returned together as a community of men in relationship with one another. I believe the first principle then, my brothers, on this special Father's Day, I want to keep encouraging us to live responsibly. Everybody say that, live responsibly. Now, fathers, I'm going to just focus in on us because it is Father's Day. I found this quote. It says that every father should remember that one day their son and daughter will follow their example instead of their advice, which means that a talk is cheap. Somebody say amen. That God is calling for a responsible way of living, even in the middle of all of our troubles, trials, and tribulations, that we still have to live responsibly. David and his men were fathers, they were caretakers, they were responsible for their communities. And they were out to fight, they were out taking care of their business, and they lived in community one with another. It is important for me to say a couple of things. First off, particularly for my black and brown men who are often targeted as being good for nothing, trifling, low down, dirty dogs, amen. Don't believe everything you read or hear. Somebody say amen, right? That when you look at research and studies, black fathers, according to the research, are just as available, if not more available, than all the other fathers that are in this country. So it is not just a challenge of black fathers, it is a challenge of fathers and men in general. That we have to be available, not just when it is convenient, but when it requires sacrifice and all kinds of other things. We have to make sure that we live up to our responsibility to be caretakers, to be fathers, protectors, caregivers, husbands, and all the different roles that we must play in a community if we will see the power and the victory of God unleashed among us. Everybody say, live responsibly. Now, the second thing that I think is important in this text is that you see that when trouble came, that David and all of his men and the people that were with him, the scripture says, they fell to the ground and wept. And they wept till there was no more strength left in their bodies to weep. And this is my counselor person coming out of me, but somebody holler weep and weep and lament. Somebody holler that. It's important for you and I to appreciate that when trouble comes, we can't be so quick to move past the stage of weeping, lamenting, and grieving. Now, this is an important narrative to lift up right now because many of us are being, urged by all kinds of forces around us, whether implicitly or explicitly, to quickly move to a place of action. And I'm one of these action-oriented people, but I find that when I don't move to action, then I have to sit in some other emotions that I'm not always that comfortable with. Do I have any witnesses in here today? Amen. That it is the impulse to keep moving, to keep, from falling apart. But sometimes you need to fall apart. Lord, help me today. Psalms 56:8, it says that God keeps track of all of my sorrows. He collects my tears in his bottle. Which means that God is also very interested in holding you and carrying you through your season of lament and sorrow. You can have the victory while you cry. You can have the victory while you're lamenting. You have time to weep. Now, I want you to think about this. David, as soon as he got back home, all of his family members, they are taken away. And David did not get right back on his horse and start running out after them. But he found time to weep. When Jesus was getting ready to raise Lazarus from the dead, Jesus found time to weep. And in the aftermath of these great horrors, I want you to know, my brothers and sisters, that we do ourselves a disservice if we do not take time to weep. The denial of our season to lament what is going on is the erasure of our humanity. When you are being pushed to move beyond your processing of your feelings, then you are being encouraged to be a robot, to be someone that has no feelings. And that is one of the moves of white supremacy, one of the moves of dehumanization, one of the moves of the devil himself, that will make you believe that you don't have to deal with the complexity of how you feel and the complexity of your struggle. Now, I'm not telling you to build a house around your grief, but I am telling you, you ought to take a rest stop at least. Amen.
Seek out our scholarly friends. We seek out every
which you can understand all the other voices that are speaking to you. Lord, help me to preach this in here. There's a whole lot of people that would tell me a whole lot of things, but as soon as I, you know, take their advice and it goes badly, there ain't a whole lot of folks who's going to stick around for the get down. It's like Brother Kirk Hendrick said, when the stuff hits the fan, are you still a fan? Amen. Y'all not ready for that this morning. Before you seek out him. stay with me. Come on, woman.